In discussing the high and increasing probability of nuclear war a couple of days ago, I made the rather obvious point that this terminal conflict is likely to erupt as a consequence of some third world conflict in which the superpowers become engaged. And I also made the equally obvious point that the two most likely candidates for such a, the point at which this terminal event will erupt are the Central America and the Middle East. I also said that American policy had been instrumental, in fact, a central factor in maintaining violence and tension and oppression and mass murder in these two regions, and still is, hence is a major factor, among other things, in increasing the likelihood that a nuclear conflict will take place, and events that have taken place since then simply underscore that observation. What I'd now like to do is to elaborate on these comments made the other night and to give some of the backgrounds and what may be some of the current prospects in Central America and the Middle East, focusing pretty much on American policy. Well, let me begin with Central America, which has been a U.S. fiefdom throughout this century, and in fact, before. Major U.S. armed intervention in Central America, major U.S. armed intervention, began in July 1854, when the American Navy bombarded and destroyed a Nicaraguan town to avenge an insult to the U.S. ambassador. In the first third of the 20th century, the United States sent military forces to Cuba, Panama, Mexico, Honduras. It occupied Haiti for 20 years. It established a military dictatorship in the Dominican Republic. It invaded Nicaragua twice, leaving a brutal military dictatorship there. In the post-World War II period, there have been American military interventions in Guatemala several times, in Cuba, the Dominican Republic, El Salvador, Nicaragua. And there has also been a 20-year war of terrorism waged against Cuba, which in fact has been the major victim of international terrorism during this period, and therefore in this Orwellian world is naturally described as the center of international terrorism in the country which is responsible for the terrorist war against Cuba and that directs the terrorist violence there. But that's standard Orwell. The most recent military intervention was yesterday, at least as of this morning. The results of all of this have been absolutely horrendous, apart from tiny elites which were placed and maintained in power by the United States and are generally linked to the American military and to American corporations. Throughout the region, there is vast starvation. In fact, since the major American escalation since the early 60s, which I'll come back to, since that time, the production of subsistence crops in the region has actually declined about 10% through the 60s and the 70s, while at the same time agricultural production has increased, but that means crops for export crops for the United States. There's semi-slave labor throughout the region. There's crushing poverty. Institutionalized high-technology torture has been introduced, and mass murder. Virtually every attempt to bring about any constructive change in these in this U.S.-installed and maintained chamber of horrors has been met with a new dose of American violence. The record is one of the most shameful chapters of modern history, and therefore, predictably, is very little known in the United States, though in a truly free society, they'd be teaching it in elementary school. In contrast, not too surprisingly, the history is quite well known in Central America. An uncomfortably accurate perception was expressed by President Arevalo of Guatemala when he stepped down in 1951. He had led the first democratic government in Guatemalan history, a sort of a liberal capitalist regime, consciously modeled on Roosevelt's New Deal, and this was an experiment that was terminated by a CIA coup in 1954. It, of course, evoked immediate and total American hostility, but that's consistent, and as I say, was terminated. Well, as he stepped down, Arevalo described the World War II conflict between the forces of terrorist violence led by Hitler and the forces of freedom and justice led by the United States, and he concluded that, contrary to appearances, I'm quoting, Roosevelt lost the war, the real winner was Hitler. In fact, if some Rip Van Winkle had fallen asleep in, say, 1945 and were to awaken today and look at Central America, and not only there, incidentally, he would certainly conclude that Hitler, in fact, had won the war. That's what the world would have looked like if Hitler had won. There are some Americans, but very few, who have been willing to face the obvious facts. Let me quote one who did face them, Charles Machling, who was the director of counterinsurgency and internal defense planning for Presidents Kennedy and Johnson from 1961 to 1966, and is now connected with the Carnegie Endowment. He wrote an article recently in which he was describing the state terrorism in Guatemala and El Salvador, and he had the following remarks to say. He said, "These atrocities are not just a tragic byproduct of civil war, nor are they accidental. Not understood by the American public, concealed by the Reagan administration, is that the Latin American military, Salvadoran, Guatemalan, or Argentine, routinely employs terror to exterminate guerrillas and insurgency movements. Devised by the Nazis for occupied Europe, perfected by Argentina, and now passed from hand to hand by Latin military staffs, the strategy involves torture and murder of anyone suspected of association with, quote, subversives. Guilt or innocence is immaterial. The object is to exterminate the opposition, and by cowing sympathizers into submission, to deprive the guerrillas of support. In their endless quest for stability south of the border, U.S. administrations repeatedly turn a blind eye to the rapacity and cruelty of the Latin American military. Not until 1961, however, and remember the date, was there direct complicity, as opposed to occasional direct interventions by the U.S. government in aiding domestic repression in Latin America. In that year, 1961, under pressure from the Pentagon, the Latin American military role was changed from hemispheric defense to internal security. U.S. assistance programs were retooled to strengthen the hold of the local military forces over their own people. For 20 years, the Pentagon has lavished training and equipment on the Latin American military, both at bases in the United States and at the U.S. Army School of the Americas in the former Panama Canal Zone. Under guise of civic action programs, Latin American officers have been encouraged to meddle in government and civilian affairs. There has been little screening to weed out the drug racketeers and war criminals, and no indoctrination in civilized standards of warfare." It's a bit of an understatement. "Senior officers, indistinguishable from the war criminals hanged at Nuremberg after World War II, have passed through the Inter-American Defense College in Washington. Neither in training programs nor thereafter does the Pentagon insist on compliance with the Geneva Conventions regarding humane treatment of prisoners and non-combatants. Equipment is given without strings. For the United States, which led the crusade against Nazi evil, to support the methods of Heinrich Himmler's extermination squads is an outrage. It is also counterproductive. Unless mass killing stops, the tide of violence will inundate the whole of Central America, and in fact, quite possibly the rest of the world, we may add." That was March 1982, the observations by the man, again, who led counterinsurgency and internal defense planning for the Kennedy and Johnson administrations. Not many have recognized these facts, though sometimes American policy is, in fact, expressed with a certain degree of honesty, or one might even say relative frankness. One State Department official put the matter in these terms, describing American policy in Latin America, I'm quoting, "The Central American area, down to and including the Isthmus of Panama, constitutes a legitimate sphere of influence for the United States. We do control the destinies of Central America, and we do so for the simple reason that the national interest absolutely dictates such a course. We must decide whether we shall tolerate the interference of any other power in Central American affairs or insist upon our own dominant position. Until now, Central America has always understood that governments that we recognize and support stay in power, while those we do not recognize and support fall. Nicaragua has become a test case. It is difficult to see how we can afford to be defeated." Well, these remarks were made by Undersecretary of State Robert Olds in January 1927, and the outside power that he was concerned about was Mexico. His reference to the national interest, like all such references, is just standard Orwellian mystification. The national interest in practice means the special interest of dominant groups in the United States or any other country. it's no more the interest of the nation than is the national, the interest, so-called national interest of any other state.